Welcome back. I hope you all had a nice lunch, and hopefully Punza and Cellulant featured prominently in your lunchtime conversation. As we move into this next section, you know, when we think about financial inclusion, it isn't enough to talk only about access. Convincing someone to open a bank account, of course, is great, but only if in addition to opening that account, they actually use it, and it becomes part of their daily life. Many believe that healthy usage simply, there's not a lot that it's simple about it, by designing products and services based on really understanding the needs and reality of the client. How simple is this really? This next session focuses in on the customer experience. If we get it right, then usage results from that. If we get it wrong, then unfortunately we experience fallout. Now get ready, because we're going to be asking you all for some of your best examples of getting it right and getting it wrong. This is going to be a very practical session. After hearing from the audience and our panel, we're going to tie it all together with an interactive learning experience. And we've already shared some tools, which you would have seen on your seats. But we'll talk through some of the tools and a guide that can help you improve the overall customer experience in order to ensure steady usage. To lead you through all of this is a man who really needs no introduction, but I'm going to introduce him anyway. Gerhard Kotze is a senior financial sector specialist at CGAP. He leads the Customers at the Center initiative, which I think is a great name. They strive to embed customer centricity in the way that financial service providers work. Before joining CGAP, Gerhard was the head of inclusive banking strategic initiatives at ABSA. He was also founder and director of the Center for Inclusive Banking in Africa, an extraordinary professor in agricultural economics at the University of Pretoria. Please welcome Gerhard to the stage.
Well, I feel a bit lonely. I thought my team is going to walk out with me. But it is an immense and extreme pleasure to be here. Very good. Now I feel better. It is really a great pleasure to be here and to sit with this team of people on the stage. And what we are really going to do in the next 90 minutes is we really want to start a conversation with you all. And I must tell you, I'm so impressed with the setup that sort of brings the conversation to the middle of the room, people sitting quite nearby. It doesn't look like 300 people. It looks like a conversation, a sitting room, you know, sitting on a couch. Just don't get too relaxed, but anyhow. So what we're going to do, Jason actually already explained what we are going to do. But what is important here is that we start with the customer. We had Pumsa on the stage this morning, and we are leaving her here. We want her to stay, and we're going to add Irene Nadople. Irene is from Kenya, Nadople is from Ivory Coast. We want all three of them on the stage. And after getting Irene and Adople's views, we will turn to you, the audience, and start the conversation there. You will note that I'm not really introducing my panel, because they're not as important as you are. And we'll get to them. So let us start with the videos. And then after the videos, we'll take it to the audience, and then to my panel. Thanks very much.
Majina yangu ni Irene Ndunge. Nilikuja Water 2012. Niko na watoto wawili. Nimekaa hapa kwa 3 years. Kwa hii nyumba tunaishi watu wanne. Mimi, mzee wangu na watoto wangu. Tulikuja wote kikazi. Kaa sijapata kazi ya kufua nguo, hakuna kazi nyingine. Ni ya housewife tu. Venye kazi iko sasa, nikienda nikipata kazi kidogo, huwa napata hiyo 250. Nikipata kazi ni mingi, mwisho inakuwa 400. Sasa kama chakula inaweza beba 200 na niko na 400, naweka hiyo 200 na 200 natumia tu kwa chakula, matumizi ya nyumba. Kama saa hii mahali huwa nafua, kuna duka na kuna M-Pesa. Huwa na wakinipea, napitia tu hapo naweka kwa M-Pesa. Kwa sababu M-Pesa ni account na ikati pesa, hata ukiweka hapo utapata tu penye ulieka, ndio zinatoshana. Wakati mwingine huwa natumia bank. Kwa sababu unajua, nikiweka kwa M-Pesa, kuna target yenye naweza kuwa nimesema, ninaweka kwa M-Pesa, nikiweka kwa M-Pesa, alafu sasa ndio nipeleke kwa bank. Unajua sasa zikiwa tu hapo kwa M-Pesa, nikipatwa na shida kidogo, nitaenda tu nichukue, lakini zikiwa kwa bank, zitakuwa tu ni ngumu kiasi. Na M-Pesa, wanafaa kureduce charge yao, wa-reduce, alafu kuna shida ingine ya delays. Sababu za zingine unaweza pata kuna delay, na wewe uko na mtu wako mbali, maybe ulikuwa unataka kumtumia pesa, na maybe ni mgonjwa, sasa inakuwa tu ni shida. Sasa wangerekebisha at least hizo delays ziishe, ingekuwa poa. Alafu kama ni hizi maroni za M-Shwari, si iko tu kwa M-Pesa. Ingekuwa vizuri kama wangeongeza muda wa kulipa, ndio at least mtu awe amejipanga. Kaa tu months hivi, 3 months. Mi siku za mbeleni ningetaka watoto wangu wao wamesoma na ninunue plot nijenge, alafu hata kaa nikununua kijaka, kwa sababu huko kwetu hakuna vijaka. Hakuna mtu, unapata tu mtu ni mali tu amejenga hivyo, na hakuna mali anaweza hata lima. Itanisaidia kwa sababu nikilima, si chakula natoa hapo, sitakuwa nazunguka kutafuta chakula. Sasa itakuwa maisha imekuwa tu at least, sio kama saa hii. C-D-E-A-T-F-G-H-I-J.
Je suis menuisier. J'ai 38 ans. J'ai 3 enfants, 2 filles et un garçon. Je travaille beaucoup sur chantier. Donc, à travers mon téléphone, c'est ça que je sors. Donc, dès que je suis à la maison, ça m'appelle. C'est parti, je suis parti. Ça fait bientôt 2 ans que je connais MTN Money. Donc, je dépose l'argent là-bas, je vais, je retire. Si je vais envoyer l'argent quelque part, je fais partir l'argent sur mon compte. Je peux payer comme on appelle facture de mon courant dessus, CIE, que ce soit CIE ou bien SODC. Bon, j'ai un compteur. J'ai appris, bon, par exemple, envoyer un message ou bien prendre crédit. Il y a un jour, ils sont venus me braquer. Un jour, j'ai pris l'argent de quelqu'un, 454 000 avances de quelqu'un pour faire sa maison, pour mettre toiture sur sa maison. Ils sont venus me braquer la nuit, ils m'ont cassé la tête. Si mon argent est chez MTN Money, qui va venir à la maison et qui va trouver l'argent? Personne, tu ne vas pas venir à la maison trouver l'argent. J'ai déposé là-bas, c'est un code. Si quelqu'un me donne son argent, il faut faire mon travail. J'ai un boutique. C'est chez lui, je m'avais, je dépose l'argent chez lui. Lendemain, je prends l'argent, je m'avais, je fais les achats de la personne. Et puis je viens, je fais son travail. Maintenant, quand ils m'ont parlé de MTN Money maintenant là, laissez mon ami boutique là, c'est MTN Money maintenant, je suis branché sur lui jusqu'à aujourd'hui. Mais c'est qui? Je n'ai pas encore fait ça sur le téléphone moi-même. C'est comme on appelle là. Même j'ai plein de pays, je fais partie de l'argent. C'est moi qui dois faire coup de ça pour faire les restes là. Sinon, MTN n'a rien à voir dans ça. Au travail que j'ai fait là, je ne suis pas payé à la fin. Donc, je n'ai pas un truc comme ça. Je vais aller faire quoi à la banque? Au fait, moi, c'est que pourquoi moi, je me suis jamais intéressé à la banque. Je sais pas lire. Ceux qui savent prendre l'argent, quand tu vas partir prendre l'argent, signature que tu as, quand tu as les premières signatures là, quand tu t'en vas, même signature, est-ce que quand tu signes ton chèque là, et quand tu signes pour prendre ton argent, si c'est pas c'est la même signature là, tu ne prends pas ton argent. Moi, je sais pas lire. Pour mieux faire, c'est pour ça, moi, mais je garde ça à la maison. Un jour, ils sont venus casser ma tête là, donc j'ai trouvé boutique, je garde ça chez lui. Pas boutique, j'ai trouvé MTN maintenant, je suis soulagé.
You have seen 6 minutes of customer stories, and there's such a lot of messages in those two little vignettes of their lives. How do you feel from the audience side? How do you feel? Do you resonate? Do you pick up something that is something that you've seen in your everyday life when you interact with your with your customers? Are there things that you have solved which you've observed here? Let's hear from the audience a little bit, just your voice. Comments. You don't have to ask questions, just make a comment. Oh, we have a comment. Yeah. No, we'll just wait for the mic. And we're waiting for you.
Campbell, local regional director for Fink in Africa. Just a comment. I think that we underscore the importance of client education. And when I say client education, that's really a little bit of hand holding that's needed for people to adapt to the new technology and to understand the value proposition for people that fear that they can't write or just the newness of the way we now interact with the customer. And I think a lot of resources need to be put into those type of on-the-ground grassroots efforts.
Yeah, I think it's a great observation. It's something we call, how do we empower the customer? We have a hand over here, and I'll go through the groups. Any more hands? Okay, hand over here, mic just to the front row. Thanks, Lauren.
Thanks. My name is Lauren Hendricks with CARE. I just have a question or a comment. You know, I think as a lot of us are moving towards working with mobile money agencies like MTN or M-Pesa, it's struck me for a long time that we're putting our clients' experience, we're sort of outsourcing that to other organizations, and organizations that we have very little control over how they manage their agent networks. And so how that integrates with client centricity when we're kind of, in a lot of ways, moving farther from our clients.
That is such a great question. You should have asked it just before I closed the audience interaction, because it's exactly what Jennifer and Marem is going to speak about. So great stuff. We were getting to there. We have Francis there, and then gentlemen from the new small finance bank. Francis?
Yeah, hi. Francis Fraser from Positive Planet. I was quite amused with the idea that she would keep her money on her phone for easy access, but keep it in the bank so that it was safe. And it, aside from it being a bit amusing, I think having that ability for all the tools that we create to help people with discipline that they struggle with themselves is an important lesson that I took out.
Yeah, I know. And in a way, the behavior here is the big thing. There's first a sort of recognition of my own way of handling my money. And therefore, I use tools like the mobile phone and the bank to help me to use my money in a way that actually protects against myself. So.
Yeah, there was one more observation, which did not get shared in as many words, but with what we got a feedback from people was going to this corner shop or some of these agents is something that they can relate to, where they go on a daily basis for something or the reason, and they would know that they will not be disrespected. And it's a apprehension, not that it's a reality, but the apprehension is to going to a more organized setup at times can bring them in a awkward situation where they may not really be seen as a welcome person, even though they may want to be only a depositor, which pushes them to actually in the unorganized space or some of this mobile money space right
now. Yeah, no, I think it's a great observation. We have a Doppler who speaks about sort of his fear of going to the bank, but you see him quite comfortable with the agent. Although I had a little indication that agent should have been a bit more proactive as well, but that's just me. There's a hand over here.
Hi, Drew Johnson from TechnoServe. Just was really terrific videos. I was struck that both of those customers were very competent users of the basic service, and they were maybe both looking for more services beyond sending and receiving money, banking, and other types of financial services.
Yeah, oh, good observation. And we knew that we're going to have a savings group video this morning, so we don't want to create the impression that all these lessons are just in the sort of mobile space, but we knew we had that. So we thought we'll focus a little bit on the mobile space here, and we do see the comfort. In fact, I don't know whether you've read about the Brock Bcash exercise where they actually teach people to use their mobile phones, not to do financial transactions, to use their mobile phones, because a lot of people are really scared of using the phone. Anyhow, we have more observations, questions before we go on. We've got a hand. Okay, let's go there, and then we go secondly there.
Right. Hello, good afternoon. My name is Ross Nathan from Vision Fund International. When adopting technology, we always think that one size fits all in all the countries. So I think we have to rethink that strategy. Thank you.
Yeah. I tend to think about journeys and what is the starting point of the journey. The starting point of the journey is the reality of the client, not your reality. We had another observation there.
Thank you. I'm Devota Minzi from Tanzania. I was just wondering if maybe it's time to think of economic inclusion rather than... Okay, we have done a good job maybe on financial inclusion, but when I'm looking to what that Kenyan ladies was talking about the dream of having the plot, doing what? So I'm tending to think maybe we should think on how these people could think big, because I don't think the issue, the financial inclusion, having the mobile phone, doing the transacting would solve her problems. To me, I think maybe there's a big role of financial education, mindset change, so that these people who now maybe are already included, what can be done so that they could think big and, you know, reach their dreams? Thank you.
Thank you. I deem that observation such a powerful observation, because as a fraternity, we tend to focus so much on the financial side that we tend to forget people's lives are much more than that. We've seen our Doppler with his cabinet or whatever he's doing, cabinet-making business. We've seen Irene with washing clothes. And how can you enhance their opportunities there? Isn't there an Uber opportunity to get people with time and with skills to opportunities? I'm not sure, but maybe there is. But that is a good observation. So is there any last observation before we turn? Sorry, I can't even see myself. Okay, there, very good.
Hi. Yeah.
Okay, we've got Mr. Stone, please calm down. We've got somebody up there, and then we'll do a quick one there. Very
good. Hi, my name is Tukril. I'm with Microinsure. I think one of the things we should also consider when we are talking about this is the design of distribution channels and the sales. One key question is, who owns the customer? In the two examples that we saw, we talked about M-Pesa and then we talked about MTN. I would say neither MTN nor M-Pesa actually own the customer. It's the retailer. Because the relationship he has or she has with the customer is the one that makes the decisions at the end of the day. So I think that's very important when we talk about the distribution design.
I think that is a pertinent observation, although I do disagree with you slightly. I think the customer owns the customer. And I think the retailer owns the relationship. And I think that's very important to understand, because I worked for a bank for 7 years, and we tend to think that we own people and we own clients. We don't. Maybe if we stop thinking about owning, and I'm not saying you saying that, I'm just using your response to make this point, maybe we will think better and more and respect clients more when we stop thinking about that banks own clients. Mr. Stone, please. Yeah,
well, I was very excited because I was excited by the previous intervention about economic inclusion, because
yes.
I think we don't talk enough in these fora about Amartya Sen's capabilities approach. Not capability in the sense of financial literacy, but in the economy as a whole, finance is what enables people to do what they want to do. Mm-hmm. It's a means, not an end. And what this lady was talking about is we need to focus much more about on how finance improves the capabilities of people to buy her plot, to develop his business, and so on.
Yeah. No, I'm totally with you there. And I think also that it's a nice topic for the next gathering, as is customer empowerment, when Mike took the mic first. Yeah. Thank you very much for that. We'll come back to you just now, start working on those questions. So now, you see in the interim, we got the slide of the five pillars. And this is what we are doing, working on the whole time with the team there at SIGEP. But I thought I'll put up the slide, because those of you who were at this conference last year in Turin actually would remember this. And basically, those are the five focus areas that we think that you have to focus on in a financial service provider to embed customer centricity as a business model. So this is just to remind us that this morning we looked at leadership and culture. Now we are looking at customer experience, but they are very interrelated and inextricably linked with each other. So it's not as if we're doing the sort of pillar-wise approach, we're doing one thing by the other thing. And tomorrow you'll hear from our morning keynote speaker how many moving parts there are in this equation. So we are on customer experience, and we have very experienced people around this, well, I nearly said table. Here's a table. And I'm going to turn to you first, Jennifer. And what I want to ask you is, you have extensive experience, so much so that you are now working with your company Top Image in 12 countries, doing what you're going to tell us about just now. And I'm not going to give you any more introduction to any more of them other than a one-liner, because you can read it in here, and they're all accomplished. So, Jennifer, you have extensive experience in the reality of the interface between clients and agents. Okay. What are the issues at this interface regarding negative and positive customer experience? And running into problems with a consistent delivery in front, Lauren, yeah, consistent customer experience in front. You are the providers are sitting all here at the back, and then your company comes and they say, "Well, we can't get this right. Let's retrain. Let's do it. Let's test it, etc." Tell us a little bit about that. Start with the negative, get to the positive, and the how. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. As you've heard, my name is Jennifer Barasa. I'm the CEO of Top Image. We provide services to MNOs, and we are already in 12 African countries. What I do, I'm an interface between the agent and the consumer, or the client, or the customer. So what we just saw on the video, I jotted a few things down. One of them is the network reliability. So what do we do as an MNO or MFS on customer reliability? Because if there's no customer reliability, then you are not providing the customer the service, and therefore you're not being customer-centric and so on. So it's very important to have a reliable system. And I've seen this both for myself in Kenya, that I want to send some money, and I'm not able to do so because sometimes the system down. But I can tell you, in Kenya, it's better. Safaricom has done a better job. Not because it's interesting, I work for Safaricom also, and I worked with them before the launch of M-Pesa up to date, and now I also work with MTN in Cote d'Ivoire. So you say that actually there is much better. It's worse off in some West African countries where the system is always on the blink, you cannot know how many transactions have taken place, and therefore even the agent himself cannot know how many transactions they have done if they are not put down in a book to write. So those are one areas we say that the downturn that both the customer or the client might not know what they have done. It takes a long time. Or even when they are starting, they don't have what we call the start key. So they might not start using the service. But for reliability and so on, it's very easy. We have seen both from water and also in Cote d'Ivoire. But so what I'm saying that network issues can be done. You can upgrade your network. You can change the provider. For Kenya, for example, they could do segmentation. I saw Irene saying she would like more products. And how do we get that? By talking to our customers continuously or the client and so on to find out their needs, being market-centric, being client-centric as opposed to product-centric when people are thinking of the bottom line, which most MNO and MFS will be thinking about product. What is the revenue? What is it bringing for us? Instead of saying, what does the customer want? And this brings me to the next question, that maybe there's need for what we call market segmentation so that there is a service that will satisfy the need of Irene. She needs to get a saving account, although this Mushwari is a loan account. Maybe now the next level is get a savings account so that this so there's more inclusion that she can buy the plot that she wanted to buy and so on. The period of payment, that also can be worked on depending on what she's asking for.
May I interrupt you?
Yes.
I hear what you're telling us, and I'm wondering, if you right where you started, if you have clients persistently complaining about, say, network downtime, and they complain to the agents, mm-hmm. okay, how do you, as an interface, as a training organization, how do you correct that?
Yeah, what we normally do, because we have daily reports, I have people who call on agents on a daily basis on a circle. Most MNOs and MFIs would not have the kind of scale I have of outsourced patients. For example, in Nigeria, I have 200 employees doing the same thing. I think in Ivory Coast, there are 90. Nairobi, Kenya, yeah. They're over 130. So on a daily basis, we talk to them. We get the reports on a daily basis and a report to Safaricom of MTN so that they can work on it immediately. And in fact, issues like those ones, we say they must be reported immediately by my team. Yes.
Just a follow-up question on that.
Yes.
Because I really like this. So what you are doing is you are training your trainers.
Yes.
To actually interact with the clients, pick up those problems, mm-hmm. and take them back to the service providers. So,
yes.
So the agents become like the recourse mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
And that's consistent?
That's very consistent. Okay. And that's why it's important that MNOs and MFS to have someone who will consistently be able to get in touch with the client plus the agents. Because really, an MNO and MFS, they might not have the scale to do so on a daily basis and so on. So with their eyes and ears and so on, and they are in control. Actually, they're still in control of the system because I work for them and we have to report to them.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's the reliability and the cost. That cost is when you do the segmentation. Segmentation, you talk to your customers, being eccentric to find out what it is. Then, of course, that's what I talk of, the needs of the new product. And then now the second video is called about confidence, where I've seen a lot in West Africa that the person has a wallet, but they hardly, sometimes they know they have a wallet because the training was not done very well. They are not even aware. They don't have their start key. They cannot use the product. And when they cannot use the product, they are not so sure. And it's because of literacy levels, they are very low. So you find that instead of being convenient, you find that the client will leave their house, like the gentleman left in Cote d'Ivoire, to go and use an agent. So an agent becomes very important interface between the provider and the client and so on. And that's why it's important to train those agents very well. like the back of your hand, to understand the product so that they are the first interface of your product and the client. And that's where we see the problem. The problem comes to that. Therefore, if a problem like that occurs, what do you need to do? Massive consumer education, one-on-one, face-to-face communication, which we do on massive scales, so that they understand. Let them touch the product, go through the product and so on, because they don't understand. Technology is very intimidating and so on. So what most I propose that usually MNO, anybody who is launching this product, to the unbanked, to the poor, to uneducated, you need to do a lot of massive customer education and so on. Take care of your 24 hours customer care center, so if there are issues, so that customers, if they have problems, they can answer questions. Train the customer care centers very well, and et cetera. I know I'm running out of my time.
Oh, you're near, question.
You're thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Right. I really like this point about what we call customer empowerment, you know. And there is this thing called agent empowerment as well. If the agents understand the products, that's easier for them to explain it to the customer. We often get it so that frontline staff don't even understand the products of the financial service provider they're working for, which makes it just totally impossible for the customer to get the right message. Kunrad, now recently, well, it's not recent anymore, it's nearly a year, you've been appointed as the head of digital at Commonwealth Bank, but your real experience comes from South Africa. And we thought that we should have at least one South African that knows something about these things in the panel.
That's pressure.
So it is easy when you are face to face with somebody. Say, yes, let's train the agent. Well, it's not easy. It's easier. Let's train the agent well. Let's sort of get a system going. But Kunrad, now, you built a digital interface from scratch. You shared that you follow an outside-in approach. Okay. What does this mean, and what customer experience examples can you share with which you can illustrate this outside-in approach? And how did you solve the challenges that you pick up? So firstly, how do you pick up challenges when you don't speak to the customer eye to eye? And how do you solve these? And your job is to bring digital and customer experience together for us here. So I'm going to sit down.
Thank you, Gerard. Yeah, as you said, you know, here in South Africa and now in Asia, we do digital banking for individuals and small businesses. And as Bob pointed out this morning, this digital thing has great promise to give us ultra-low-cost distribution at enormous scale. But the central question is whether this will allow us to meet our ultimate objective, which is to enhance the economic value for our customer. So are we going to be able to enhance our customers' economic experience through this? And this is particularly difficult in a context where most of the heavy lifting in engaging with customers is really done through these things, through a digital interface, and through till point operators and owner managers of small businesses that we don't employ. And the question is, can we do this? Can we create and enhance economic well-being for our customers through this? And in this, the big challenge is that our customers are judge, jury, and executioner for us while we're not there. So when our customer sits at the kitchen table at night, dialing a USSD string and opening an account around the kitchen table, without the help of another human being next to her to help her, she will vote with her fingers. If this thing is too tough, if this is not enhancing her economic well-being, she will abandon that process, and we won't be there to help her. When our customer walks to the corner store, and wants to draw money at the corner store, and that corner store employee is rude to her and not supportive, our customer will vote with her feet, and she'll walk out. And so what I decided I'll do for this afternoon is give one fairly pedestrian example of a situation in which we thought we had a great idea, we executed it, and we failed, and we learned some surprising things from it. So in our South African operation, most of our customers use our account for money transfers. And like many of us, we had the challenge of convincing the customer to keep the money in and use it for other things, such as buying airtime. And we devised a plan, which we thought at the time was a great plan, to give the customer 5% of the face value of the airtime that they buy back as cash into their account. We thought this would be quite attractive for customers, 5% of the value of airtime back. And we punted this heavily with customers. So every time somebody got money into their account, we reminded them, if you keep the money in, you get 5% of the value back as cash into your account. The take-up was very disappointing. And from that, we learned three interesting things. The first thing is that, and Ignacio Moss will appreciate this, that most customers valued liquidity and flexibility in what they do with their money over the 5%. So I don't know how much airtime I'm going to buy or how much electricity I'm going to buy. I'd rather have the cash and be able to spend it on all the other things I need my money for, especially if I got it as a money transfer, where mostly I get the money because I need it for something. The second thing we learned from a small group of customers who did use the service and used it a lot. So there was about 7,000 customers at that point that made up to 80 transactions, small microtransactions a day, buying airtime on the account. What we learned is that the 5% we gave back was slightly higher than the margin that the smallest distributors were getting in the chain for buying airtime, and customers were actually using this, or merchants of airtime was actually using our platform to resell airtime. And we then sort of created a special little piece for them where they could use it, and that has since become a sub-segment, selling airtime through our platform. And the third thing we learned is when we gave up and switched off the 5% for our ordinary customers, the people who were using this account of ours to buy airtime continued to use it to buy airtime. So we were actually wasting the 5% that we were giving back to them. They continued to use it. Now, from this humbling experience, I do think that there was another, if we lift one level up, another set of interesting learnings at a more abstract level. The first learning for me, and this story illustrates it, but I have so many stories to illustrate this. The first learning is we don't know what our customers want. And we really need to stop suffering from a God complex that thinks that we know. The second lesson for me is that if we listen carefully and in the right way, our customers will tell us what they want. And the third lesson is if we follow them, if we listen, and we respond to what they need, our customers will reward us with a relationship. Those 7,000 airtime resellers have now doubled and trebled, and they've become a very important customer group for us, very loyal to us because we give them something that nobody else gives. Thanks, Harold. That was useful.
That is great. Thanks very much. So, lesson here is that we must be completely counterintuitive. We must not force our own behavior as the sort of known behavior or the only behavior. And then I like this one especially. They will tell you. They will tell you. Do we give them an opportunity to tell you? We'll get back to that. No, Marem. It was great to meet you yesterday already.
Yes.
And we are coming back to the agents, but it's a different type of organization. Here it was a sort of in between, okay? But your job is to deliver for Microcredit Senegal.
Exactly.
And you have a great experience in the management consulting work world all over the world. And 2 years ago, you arrived there at Microcredit Senegal, and they told you about our agent system. Now, I must just remind the audience, those of you who remember, is last year in Turin, we had Mark Fleming from Microcredit, and he told us what they're doing on their sort of innovation unit, central unit, and you actually come from that unit, and you've been parachuted into Microcredit Senegal, and you must go forth and implement. Tell us about that. Tell us how you went about. Tell us your learning there, and tell us where are you today with rolling out that agent platform for basically an entity that used to be a classical microfinance institution selling credit. Thanks.
Okay. I was the only one who voted to sit down, actually, and everybody wants to be up, so I'm up now.
You can still sit.
No, it's okay. Now I'm here. So, as he stated, Microcredit is a financial institution providing financial services, and traditionally we used to be very much microcredit oriented, giving credit to poor people and micro entrepreneurs. 2 years ago, we started a new mass market strategy, and for that we adopted the HCD process, and I was part of the early team who tried to think about how we should refocus on the client to be able to deliver new product. And we were very ambitious, and we are still, and we wanted to be like the leader in each of the countries we are today, and having the million client. Today, Microcredit Senegal is 150,000 clients, and we have 3 more years to get to the million. So, saying that, if you want to get the million clients, you have to rethink the way you work, and a mono product won't help. So you have to broader your segments, and that's what we started by opening, trying to see what the worlds look like and how we can help them solve other issues than just loan and savings. So, and to do that, you have to be able to deliver your services. That's where everything started with the ADC program in Microcredit Senegal, having new delivery channels. And we started with the agent network, both in Senegal and Madagascar. So in Senegal today, where we are, we have, like yesterday I've just checked, we have 486 points, 1 year and a half. We started the first agent, we launched it 1st August of 2014. After a pilot, we have like tested in many areas, wanted to see whether the client were receptive, to test our technology also. And what was great is we tested it with our own client, but also with our own staff. We have 700 staff, and those people are clients, employees, and they are the best people where you can learn how they are clients, they are normal people too. And they have the same needs than any other clients. So we have like a mixture of our own staff being involved in testing those new initiatives we had, and also doing some, I'll say, like we called it safari, going to the field and try to get their life to have like a customer journey before being able to deliver this new agent network. So I joined her when she was saying, isn't it very complicated to externalize this relationship? In Microcredit, we decided to internalize it. So we have putting in place a whole department in charge of managing those agents. So we are recruiting them, like selecting them, recruiting them, train them, and following them. So I have like a team of 25 people for those 500 agents doing regular visits, because we really believe that if the agent is happy, he will deliver and give the right experience to the clients that you send to him. And that's what we see. One other thing is, which is important, is also the system. It is very important to have a strong system to be able to start going on the field. You cannot afford to externalize this type of services if you're not ready, technically.
because it will get back to you and you will give a poor experience to your client and they will just go back to the old system because a bad client will just word to mouth, it will give it a bad experience and you won't be able to adapt. So we had to be very agile and being always on the field to understand what the people want, starting by our staff. We made it free, the whole transition, for them to be able to come back and give us some feedback. So we put some internal tools so that they can give us quickly feedback. We put in place, in parallel, a free toll access line so that any client can complain or even the staff, and that makes it work. So just we have like 400 agents, 86, and in 1 year only 6 has left, and 2 of them because they didn't have money on their own initiative, only 2 of them since the beginning of the project. So it means like they're still happy, they are still committed to work with us, and part of it is because we are much giving them a real follow-up, trying to help them, trying to take them as client to understand what they need, deliver a user-friendly interface so it's going to be easier for them because we don't want to mix, because those people, they have their own shop, their own business. So you are bringing them new businesses. You have to make sure it don't disturb much what they are used to do, and it's going to be smooth and easy. So that's the experience of Microcredit Senegal. And we still have some challenges to face because the more we grow, the more it's going to be very difficult. So we have to figure out new ways of being always on the top, on the front end, to be able to quickly escalate and take the right actions. So, and I will also add that we almost forget that the clients are very demanding now. So really sometimes, they are the one, if I am a client and my mom is the first one, she goes to an agent, if she has a bad experience, she will come and complain. It is my money. It's not the same in the bank level. If you go to an agent, a shopkeeper, you will feel like it's your money. So he has to give you your money. He doesn't have to treat you bad because you are the one asking for the money. And I think that people will feel more and more comfortable. We have to do more client education, but I also think that the more and more people, if they feel comfortable with the institution, they will be eager to be more demanding, and if we give them the space to do so. If you give them access to be able to complain and... Yes, I don't know if I did my time.
You actually have a little bit left, but you are most welcome.
I have a little bit left, okay.
To sit down and then we go on with the audience. Thanks very much.
Okay.
Do you realize that... Point.
I forgot something very... I wanted to discuss about this young man we saw on the video. And to illustrate the fact that we took into account the customer journey, we did select a technology which is more related to that. So if a client wants to go do a transaction at the agent, he will use only his finger. So we decided to use biometrics. And really, we have like good adoption rate thanks to that, because most of the people we are serving are not able to read. And that way, they will feel less afraid to do. They don't have to write down. They don't have to sign. So I just put my finger, and I feel very secure. So anytime I go somewhere, sometimes people just like, oh, microcredit. So I mean, that's something that's easy their lives.
Yeah. Thanks very much. When we started working on the cost customers must incur to be served in our little group at SIGAF, one of those costs is the cost to identify yourself, the cost to have an ID, the cost to have an address. And we tend to sort of take that for granted. In fact, we take many things for granted. If you listen to the conversation we had thus far, just to make a small tweak in terms of a recourse system that gets feedback and a toll-free line, that's a massive operational exercise to get that in place and working. And we often tend to ignore the fact that you have an operational part, the second pillar, in your institution. It needs to be aligned in this way, right? And it needs to deliver on that nice technical idea you have, Kunrat. And that pain of getting that through the system is just immense. So I think what you hear here is the tip of the iceberg, and below lies a lot. Right, so just as a sort of observation. Marem, thanks a lot. So let's go back to you, our fellow discussants around the table, around the floor. And maybe you want to add, maybe you have an observation. What do you think about the fact that we've mentioned segmentation four times now? It's something that that all of you basically mentioned. I mean, I mentioned a little bit, but you guys said segmentation. You said you looked at different levels of customers in the behavior they've exercised. You alluded to segmentation in your chat. Is that an important thing? Is this a post-lunch problem? Ah, we have a mic. Yeah, thanks.
Hi, Solana Kotso here from MasterCard. Super important. Couldn't agree more with the segmentation criticality. We used to talk about the base of pyramid. We used to talk about financial inclusion. We used to talk about a bucket, which was sort of the underserved, right? And the unbanked and the underserved. And we thought that all of their needs were similar in a way, right? And we had this cookie cutter approach. And as we began to dig deeper, we fully understood that it was critical for us to be able to sub-segment that approach. And so we started to peel the onion. And of course, we went from one huge sub-segment into 25. And then we went back and simplified it a little bit. Where we're landing now is we're basically looking at 8 sub-segments as a starting point. And the 8 sub-segments are basically the following criteria. It's based on what your primary source of income is. So if your primary source of income is some sort of formal salary or a government benefit, or if you're an entrepreneur, right, or informal salaries, then we cut that through whether you live in urban or rural areas. And then finally, some sub-segments, we cut through gender. Right, because we do believe that in some cases it's really important whether you're a man or a woman in terms of the types of solutions we need to deliver. So that's the way we're approaching then the understanding the segment, so that we can then, from a technology standpoint, build the right solutions that will incur usage.
Thank you very much. Robert?
Yeah.
Oh, there we are.
Which is that we tend to, when we hear this term, customer-centric, our mind goes straight to the client, the end kind of beneficiary, user, person who's buying the service. And I think we've heard a lot about agents and other participants and influencers who are part of the decision-making, part of the service experience. And I think what underlies that is that those same tools and methods, that same approach that's very kind of need-driven and participatory can be applied across all those layers. And a lot of organizations find that their greatest value starts to emerge when they really focus on some of those other links in the chain and not just trying to figure out how to cut through such a broad sort of population or segment.
Very good. Steve, before I get to you, I often look at this sort of whole thing of segmentation is smoke and mirrors kind of stuff, because people go and segment because somebody told them to segment and then they do nothing with it. So it's extremely important to have a very good objective why you want to do that. Steve, there's a question and then we come to you.
Okay. Hi, Steve Peachey from World Savings and Retail Banking Institute. I agree absolutely that your segmentation has to have a practical end to it. And one of the critical things we found running out services to the rural poor is you actually have to know how many dollars makes poor. You know, if you don't know what people are living on, you have absolutely nothing to benchmark your pricing. against. But the other thing we've found, you know, everyone knows that there's a growing issue of young adults staying in the parental home. In the places we're working with, 40, 50% of the unserved are these young adults, sometimes stretching into their late 20s, who, you know, have a completely different set of needs from the lead householders who are managing the whole household budget. And, you know, we actually, in the end, we had to go out and do some participatory research to find out what those needs were. And we did a little diary study to try and find out how much money these guys handle themselves. And it's completely different from the householders. And averages just lose you the picture completely.
Thanks for that. We have an observation there at the back, and Kunra, then I'll come to you, and then we'll go over here. And anything? Yeah, there we are. Right. There's somebody next to you on your right-hand side. Yeah.
Thank you. Mayada Baidas from Lebanon. I have a general question, which is, how much are the technologically driven solutions to financial inclusion overlapping with financial intermediation? Is that a completely, is it the same set, or do we have a much smaller subset that is financial intermediation?
Have the question?
Yeah, just for a moment back on the segmentation. I think something we really grapple with around segmentation is that doing large scale, highly scalable solutions in some sense is at odds with being very flexible and detailed in our segmentation. And the way we're starting to think about it is that what you need is you need a highly scalable platform. But on that platform, you need to be able to respond. We need to be able to respond much more rapidly to segments almost as they emerge. So rather than think of a segmentation framework as a fixed framework, we actually allow the data to tell us what segments arise in our market, and then we must allow ourselves, as well as our partners and other participants in the ecosystem, to dynamically respond to that. And I don't know whether this is maybe a response to the question of intermediation, but more and more I see that no one player is going to be able to do enough innovation, enough response to actually dynamically respond to the market. And so specifically as large players, banks, insurers, we should think of ourselves as establishing the platforms and allow the market to actually innovate around it. And that means by its very nature that we will be disintermediated. We will engage in a much more complex environment in which sometimes we will be reselling things that other people manufacture, and sometimes other people will be reselling things on top of what we manufacture.
Yeah, just to add on that, I think with the MNOs and everybody, because you have a system, you can do what data mining, so that you have the information. You always have the information. Therefore, the segmentation cannot be so difficult, as opposed to some people who don't have that kind of information. Because when you look at the wallet, you can know how much this person puts on the wallet, how many times do they leave the money in the wallet, and do they? It just pay system through that they cash in and then cash out, or do they keep it for 2 weeks and so on? And from the volume of the cash they have in it, you can now segment your market. Those are data mining. Data mining.
Thank you. Mayara, was your question answered? Sort of. Right. We have somebody right over here, and then I'm also going to ask. My apologies, sir. I forgot about the person before you. Right, please.
Hello, I'm Renee Chauberoff from Pamiga. I want to come back to the segmentation and client centricity question, because I really wonder if we are not in one of those chicken and egg kind of thing, because if you determine the segmentation before you listen to the clients, then there is a problem, because you are already predetermining the kind of answers into the time of needs that the clients is going to have by the category in which you are putting them. And I truly think that a client is not only determined by his income pattern or his professional status, farmer or wage earner or something like that. I really believe that it there are so many factors, time in life, the challenges, the constraint, there are so many things that can determine the behavior of a client that I truly think that we should not rush too quickly into segmentation, because then we will fall into the same problem that we had before, which is the product development aspect of the whole thing.
Cannot agree with you more. Before I get to you, sir, I was listening to this, and I think segmentation, firstly, we should not consider that a static thing as well.
It's not static, yes, it's not.
Yeah, so what we have to do is there's a part about how we segment and people move, and also how we do it on an iterative basis as we learn more. Okay, and I think the point was well made by Renee, by Konrad, and by Jennifer. Very good, so at last.
Well, thank you. My name is Frank Nagel. I work for Rabobank. And I think there's a very good discussion going on segmentation. And always we agree on the importance of segmentation. But what do we actually do after that? We do the obligatory segmentation. And how do we do it? Basically, we do it on income. Yeah? And often, especially in rural areas, we don't have a clue about the income of farmers. So we make a lot of mistakes there. And I think we have to be more creative and more flexible. It's not static, as you just said. And look at age of people. Look at the literacy levels. Look at who will be the person in the household who manages the family pot. These are important things when you segment your market and establish your value propositions and the distribution channels. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Now, I agree with this, and I hesitate to do this, but we are working on a segmentation guide at the moment that actually acknowledges what you've just said. And there are many angles into this. There are the angles of, are you segmenting to solve problems, or are you segmenting for opportunity? Are you doing behavioral, attitudinal? Are you looking at demography? There's so many angles into it, and you have to use horses for courses. So it's great observations here, really. There was a hand on this side, but there was a lady that I saw somewhere. Ah, here. Yeah? And then we can go over there. We have time for about two more questions or observations.
My name is Rebecca from the Gates Foundation. First, I want to say that I think, Gerard, you should have your own daytime TV show. I feel like I'm on the set of Oprah for financial inclusion. I think maybe my question has almost been exhausted now. There's been a lot of discussion of customer segmentation. But when I think of it, my first instinct is to think about segmenting customers and translating that into products. But my question is whether anyone has been able to do that in terms of business models, who's been able to look at different customer segments and understand if there are different kind of on-ramps to financial inclusion that they might use, you know, pay-as-you-go or mobile commerce or different opportunities.
Thanks. So you guys want to answer this, because I can go to the audience for an answer.
I mean, I think that we know that it's likely that other sectors may be a little bit ahead of us, the telecom sector being one where there's an opportunity to feed in different business models in a pretty flexible way to customers. So I think we see it a little bit in the on-ramp in terms of kind of moving from group to individual products here. So I think that there's a lot of cross-pollination that's possible to sort of drive a little more variety. And again, it comes back to that flexibility, which is, can you build enough flexibility into your product and platform to support a natural progression between those different business models, as opposed to having different kind of channels that are a little bit hard for people to operate between.
And I would also say that we tend to sometimes think of business and operating model innovation as a once-off event, and then we do product innovation from there on, and we tweak the product. We're going to have to be much more flexible in our business and operating models, and particularly the customer journeys in coming into financial inclusion, which I think are so varied. So, you know, we're currently sort of looking at the SME space in India, and we're finding that the story of sort of customers' engagement of that customer is completely different from the retail customer in South Africa and actually goes to business model and operating model, not just to product design.
Right. I'm going to just make one observation. We will handle the question, one question there, and then I have a question for the two of you on segmentation again. But I want to speak about tellers.
Tellers.
Top agents, tellers.
Yes.
Right. So I hesitate to call somebody out to answer because quite often when you call that person, they're not in the room. They're having a coffee somewhere. So I'm not even going to call this person out, but I've seen a very nice little exercise exactly around the segmentation towards sort of onboarding customers, towards journeys that Jana Lakshmi did in India. And they have a thing called a value grid where they segment and then look at customer lifetime value of the segments and the movement between and their business challenges and how they bring that together. So there are some examples. You know, that was the question. There are some examples, Rebecca, of doing this, and we can share that kind of work with you if it's of interest. I had a hand over here somewhere, yeah. And then we're going to go to the panel again.
Hello, Ian Radcliffe from WSBI. I just wanted to pick up on the comments about allowing the data to tell us what the segmentation should tell us. Because we're often dealing with organizations where the data is not there or is very difficult to access. But there are some very interesting models that are coming out in using proxy data. And in particular, of course, mobile phones and people, the way people use their mobile phones to give their an indication of how they behave and so on. Now, much of this has been done, of course, in developing credit scoring, and there are examples from Brazil and Indonesia and various places. But I just thought I'd mention that we are doing an interesting experiment in Ghana at the moment, which is doing just this, but to develop the understanding on the propensity to save, people's propensity to save as well. And this just works, well, it's still at pilot stage, so but the feasibility is there to do that. So we were saying earlier on that the savings product is the toughest product, and I don't necessarily disagree with that, but just to say there are possibly some ways of doing this.
Thank you very much. So a quick, just an observation from you, but I just want to make a remark. When I couldn't see properly, I just saw somebody speaking there, and when they said savings products, and I listened to their voice, I was thinking of Angus Deaton, who in 1976, 78, did all this wonderful work on propensity to save. And now he's our sort of most recent economic laureate, Nobel laureate. So there's a big sort of support for the work around savings that and great academic discourse on it. So we are there. So, do you use tellers in between, so the agent, a teller, and the client? Okay, and you also have experience of tellers. Tell us, do you really focus on tellers?
Okay, in agent, like you mean operators, right? We call them operators.
Yeah, some people call them operators. You call them something else.
We call them either primary assistants for M-Pesa, and they also call them account handlers, depending on which country we are in.
Okay, so are you focusing on them at all?
Definitely. When we call agent, we mean everybody who's interacting. So we're talking about the people who are interacting with the clients. So if we're talking about the operators, right?
So
the one who's doing the transaction are the one who is going to be trained. And that's the reason why we put in place staff that are going very oftenly. Our own staff are going also very frequently to be able to notice if someone doesn't know how to do it, just quickly escalate so we can quickly fix it. And that's what we used to do. We gave them also access to be able to create their own user. And at that time, we'll know, and we know that someone new is coming in the system, and we can go and train that people.
Exactly.
So the frequency of the visit can help you achieve that, being able to be very close to the agent and since there is a lot of turnover of the...
Very good. Jennifer, you want to make an observation? I'll tell you why I'm asking you guys, because we've heard somebody somewhere over the... It may be Lembe that said it this morning, that they segment their consumers or their customers into three segments, which is more a functional segment, agents, tellers, and they call it consumers. And I was thinking after she said it, are we not missing an interface here?
No, we are not, because when we're talking about agents and we are training agents, sometimes agents are the people, the owners of the business, so they need to understand the business, and mostly they are small-scale mom-pop shops, so it's a one-man, one-woman show. So you call them an agent because they are running that business, and it's a value addition when they do your money transfer. Then you have the owner, who are an agent, who has employed two people or three to work on their behalf because they are working somewhere else or they have many shops. Those you either call them tellers or you call them primary assistants or account handlers.
They get the same training?
Yes, because they are dealing with the consumer, and we have to give them thorough training. We train them for almost a week because the experience must be the same from point A to B. The customer experience is very important, and it must be flawless and the same. Make it very rewarding and very easy to go through, so it's very important. And that's why Safaricom got it right from the beginning. In fact, before M-Pesa was launched, we trained the agents for 3 months before the launch. And we are still continuously training, even up to date, because those are the interface, the first touch point with the consumer is either what you call the teller, the agent himself, account handlers, or the primary assistant. And if you don't get it right from that particular place, and this is technology, people could not understand that you can send money on a telephone.
Very good.
Yeah, so it's very important.
Yeah. Appreciate it. Yeah. Robert, returning to you, you have to start earning your keep here.
Right. I've had an easy job so far. it's about to get a bit tougher.
Excellent. So what you are going to do is you're going to pull a few things together. Tell us, give us a little bit of a lecture on customer experience. And then after that, we are going to turn to the audience again and make observations on any of the things that you've heard, the video, etc. So thank you very much.
Well, I certainly hope it doesn't feel like a lecture, and I know I'm in the way of your next cup of coffee, which I think many of you need, I'm sure. I know I probably do at this point.
And I apologize. Robert is the head of the Design Impact Group at Dahlberg. Somebody that walks into a meeting and get excitement going around the client. So a lot of respect for that. So there
thank
you are, Robert.
You.
Please,
thank
sorry,
you.
I didn't introduce you.
Well, I wanted to start by saying it's really fun to be here. We don't use that word that much, but to be in a room like this talking about customer experience and user experience and not the boardroom of Disney or AT&T, it's really exciting to see how these ideas are being embraced by this community. So for me, it's a true privilege, and I want to thank both MasterCard Foundation and CGAP, who we've been working with and scheming a bit some of the things that you saw on your chair when you arrived. It's just a privilege to see how much these ideas are being taken to heart. But I have a bit of a tough job. I designed my first mobile application in 1998. And on the one hand, it was a super exciting experience. But I also saw how something very small could broaden into a whole set of much broader questions. Questions we're having here in this panel on customer experience that have very little to do with what might be happening on a screen, but a lot more to do with what's happening in the world around it. And I think my job here today is to both help you broaden that idea, but also help make it concrete. And I find one of the best ways to make these ideas concrete is to use the words of the people in this room. And we've been fortunate through the relationship with CGAP to be able to talk to many of you, work with a few of you on this topic. And I will be, the one advantage I have over the other speakers, I have a few visual aids here, so I'll be leaning on that a little bit. But mostly what you'll see are words from this community about how they're seeing customer experience today, where it falls in their organization, and within the sort of value they're trying to create in the market.
So I'm going to start first with a few of my own words that my team's been working on as part of building out this guide and this toolkit. So customer experience encompasses every interaction the customer has with your organization throughout the customer lifecycle, whether those interactions are in person, over the phone, or online. Pretty simple and easy, right? To deliver on. Small idea. Taking it one step further, at the heart of the customer experience is a clear and compelling value proposition, a product or service that satisfies a customer need or want across these touch points. So on the one hand, that doesn't help you that much. You've walked out saying, in order to get this right, we have to focus on everything. It doesn't really help you prioritize. Yet at the same time, we kind of intuitively know, as customers ourselves, that very little things that might happen when you speak to a call center, when you visit an agent, even when you talk to a friend, may change your perception of that customer experience. So I want to do one quick little exercise with everyone in the room. I know that this morning, we had a bit of a show of hands about bad experiences. I want to focus, I always like to start with the good stuff. It's partly my job. So I want you to be thinking about a really good customer experience you've had. Could be in a hotel, could be a retail presence, could be on a vacation. I want you to take a few minutes and think about it, and I want you to turn to someone next to you. And I want you to describe what were the qualities that made that experience special. So I just want to give you 2 minutes. Turn to the person next to you. Think of something that really brings a smile to your face. It was a great experience. What were those qualities?
I love Uber. Uber, you know, the taxi service.
Yes, I know.
Because I don't have to worry about money happening in the back. I don't have to worry about the tip happening in the back. But think about a good one recently.
All right, everybody, can I ask you to stop for 1 second? All right, time out. Can I get your attention again, please? All right. Well, first thing that was so nice is I saw a lot of smiles. Right? Those are the smiles we want to see from our customers, our agents, our tellers. Can I just get, without mics, throw out a couple of the words that came up in the conversation? What made those experiences special? Anybody? Just a couple words or qualities. What?
Friendly.
Seamless. Personal, seamless. Other things? What? Successful. Passionate.
Unexpected.
Caring. Okay. That's wonderful. And so as we think about our jobs, right, we all know that for those of us with a lot of resources and with a lot of brands competing for our time, that we have very high expectations. And we expect now words like intuitive that were the province of a few strange geeks in product design 10, 15 years ago, everyone uses them. Thanks to Apple and others. So we all know that these words apply to us, right? And if you live in the world of the private sector in wealthier markets, you spend all your time trying to find one or two of those unmet needs. And that's where a lot of this customer experience thinking comes from. But I have a question for you. How many of you truly believe that the words you just stated apply to Irene? Show of hands. And Punza. Irene and Punza. Who really believes that's true? That she's going to know the difference between something that's simple and seamless and something that's not. Seriously,
You have to believe this. If you spend time talking to people and looking at your products and whether your products bring smiles to their face, you will know that it is amazing how sophisticated the world is. I was sort of taken by the comment Ramesh made this morning about how hard they were finding the savings product to create. And the notion that one of his colleagues said, I feel like a private banker to the poor. So we really believe that, and it relates to the segmentation conversation, that it's very hard to generalize when you've got such competition at the top of this resource scale, but it's equally hard to generalize at the bottom. When needs are changing, they haven't been well documented, well researched, they're not based on the same formal distinctions that we're used to in the marketplace. So our first message to you is that you have to take these words to heart and you have to believe it. As leaders, you have to really believe it. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about customer experience from the perspective of benefits. I'm going to start with this quote that, again, comes from this community. It has become a thing to say, a type of political correctness, to talk about what do customers need and want. We all talk about it, but to be really good at it requires a special level of curiosity, empathy, and humility. And there's no abundance of these in our organizations. That's what we heard from everybody, okay? So you can all feel comfortable. You're all in the same club. So we kind of take this as our jumping off point and ask ourselves, well, what are the benefits of investing in customer experience? How can it help you? And what are the different levels? And part of what we're doing is building out a toolkit that starts with those benefits to the customer, those benefits to business, and those benefits to society. And so I'm going to walk you through a little bit of what's on that piece of paper from that perspective, starting with customers. So we had a chance to work with Jana Lakshmi on this customer experience project and walk in their shoes, both with their employees and several of the different groups that they target in the urban poor. And one of the things that came out of this loud and clear is that customer experience and product experience are very different things. And one of the quotes that we got from their organization is we needed to widen our definition. We can't be thinking about customer experience as just a way to drive use of a product. We have to be pulling back and thinking more broadly about where it sits in the lives and needs and starting a bit further back than we expected. And so we are creating tools as part of this toolkit to help you take those steps back within your organization. And we're building out a dozen different tools in partnership with CGAP that you can take into your organization, like Journey Maps, and use to sort of as forcing functions for that step back. And what we've learned is that step back can be extremely enriching, not just for the customer, but for the employee. So we ran exercises again with Jana Lakshmi, and it relates to the question we had earlier about frontline staff and some of those differences in expectation. What we find consistently is within frontline staff, there are individuals with a high degree of empathy, with a high degree of imagination, who are in some senses being held back in their ability to solve problems for customers, both the ones in front of them, but within your organization. And that if you can unlock that, you can tap into and drive a different focus and a different ownership within your employees and drive a different satisfaction in the work that they do. So another thing that we've been working on is a set of experiments, simple things. I know that Claire at MetLife has been banging her head against these experiments, so she'll talk about them, talk about this philosophy on tomorrow morning. But very simple things that are appropriate, that can be taken to individuals throughout your organization with no special skills and no special needs. And take some of the fancy words out of everything we've been talking about and bring it down to a street level. The next critical question is business value. And how do you look at business value beyond product usage, which is what we're so ingrained to be thinking about, retention, acquisition. And we've had some interesting conversations. I was fortunate to be part of a side session with a few of the folks on stage yesterday talking about business value and honing in on some different things than you might expect. Some of the things that came up in that discussion were things you might imagine, again, Paul and Claire out a little bit, this notion of how do you attach things like net promoter score to retention and earnings. So you can project out how you might influence longer term retention of customers, but some things were not as obvious. Conrad bringing up the question of risk, working with markets that you don't know that much about, where there's not a lot of proven successful models of adoption, how can you use customer experience and the ability to adjust and tweak and test out solutions all across that customer lifecycle, not just at the product level, to see where and how you can learn more quickly and create more value. And the notion that an experience-oriented approach that starts with very tangible ways of prototyping and testing new ideas and engaging not in the delivery of products and services, but in the creation of value between your agents and your customers, that there's a whole world there that can take a lot of risk out of the performance of your products and your portfolio. And finally, a focus on leadership. We've heard it threaded through from the morning. The real danger is that we get caught in the words of customer centricity. We need to connect to customer experience in a personal way. For the last 4 to 5 years, our key management team has spent 5 hours every month with consumers. It's a habit, it's the lifeblood. So we're trying to arm leaders like you with a set of organizational actions. And we've been building out a tool set from interviews with people in this room, interviews with people at really big organizations like PayPal and Amex, and at organizations across a wide range of industry, Flipkart, others. And trying to distill down what do you do at each stage as you're trying to grow this capacity towards empathy and problem solving, this capacity towards service, this ability to bring in and synthesize insights from many levels in your organization. So we're trying to turn that into also a very valuable toolkit for all the folks in this room. And finally, social value. How do we connect it back? How do we connect it, help you connect it back to the ways in which you want to make a difference in the lives of your customers and your employees both? Because they both are part of that social value equation. And what we've learned is that organizations are at very different points in this pathway. Some see customer experience and customer insights as a support function. Some are beginning to see it more as a way of engaging communities and beginning to collect data that helps them to market and drive awareness and learning. And some are starting to really embed it in the way they build and think through products and fundamentally their organizational mindset. And we're trying to create a set of tools as part of this guide that speak to people at every stage, that are drawn out of the 36 organizations we spoke to and all the secondary research we did. So that's kind of the gift that I think the CGAP team has been incubating for the last several years, building on their own experience with many different organizations in this room, and our small and somewhat challenging job. As you know, Gerhard has many ideas for where he wants to take this, is to try and bring it into a concrete package for you. And right now, we're working on a few components of that package. And if you look at this handout, it's trying to give you a sense of the chapters that are going to be part of this rich set of resources. So we're looking at how to help you make the case for customer experience in your organization, how to look at the right way to start with your customer. What are those right starting points? Is it broad segmentation so you can dimensionalize your understanding of your market? Or is it quick prototyping and tweaking of the service, the quality of service, or the information that you provide at specific touch points? So how can we help you get started? And plan and take action. How do you build and leverage the folks in your organization? And finally, making it work and sharing those results. And so we're producing a whole set of assets that we're hoping will layer into your organizations and that we can work together to kind of pilot with you over the next 2, 3, 5, 20, 50, 70 years. So thank you.
Thanks. Firstly, Robert was just giving me some feedback here about my many ideas because he told me this morning I must now slow down with my comments, they must finish somewhere. And secondly, what is important here is that I hear CGAP, but it's a great partnership to have all of you supported by MasterCard Foundation. And we are really excited about this session. and about this kind of work, because we see this is an area that really, really need inputs and guidance. People ask us questions around this. We don't have the answers, so we're jointly looking for the answers. I have literally 2 seconds left, and I wanted to come back to the audience, but I think this is part of the discussion over tea time. Did you find value from this session? Are there sort of hints of guidelines coming? Did you generate more questions that you can ask this panel over tea time? Feel welcome. And thank you for participating with such energy and vigor. Really appreciate. And lastly, thank you to the panel.